वंदे गुरु परंपराम। ओम। टुडे वी कंप्लीट द 8th चैप्टर ऑफ द भगवद गीता एंड बिगिन द 9th चैप्टर एंड व्हाइल स्टडीइंग द 8th चैप्टर व्हिच प्रेडोमिनेंटली वर्क्स ऑन क्रम मुक्ति कृष्णा हैज टेकन अ लॉट ऑफ opportunities to discuss the aspect about death and the dying. On that condition, I have given a few introductory talks about what is there within us which resists death. Today I would like to speak to you about the mind. All along I have spoken along about the disadvantages of the mind. The mind and ahankara, although they are two different things, I will take them together. Both of them come into being the moment we wake up. The moment we wake up, my mind wakes up. The moment my mind wakes up, I have a sudden feeling that I am this and everything else beyond me is not this. This is Atma. Everything is Anatma. And then the Triputi of Jiva Jagat Ishvara and the whole samsara is born. You will see when you are fast asleep, there is no samsara. The mind is not there. The ahankara is not there. And therefore, there is a definite correlation with the waking up of the mind, with the waking up of ahankara coming up to all the problems of samsara. We analyzed who in me is afraid to die. My body is an integral part. Life and death are integral part of this body. Wherever there is life, there is death. So this body cannot be afraid of its own integral part. We discovered there is a third entity, and that is the ego. The ego is afraid to die and the ego is afraid to live. And therefore, all our sadhanas come on the discovery of who is this I, and to discover what Ramana says is the lower I and the higher I. The I and the I. Or as the Mundaka Upanishad says, the lower bird and the higher bird. For transactional purposes, there is a very useful lower I. But then when I identify myself that this is my real me, then all the problems happen. And that me does not allow natural processes like death and the dying to happen. The same ahankara does not allow me to live fully. And if you have analyzed, one of the greatest gifts that we have is the gift of life in this moment. Now, meditate on these words. The greatest gift we have all the time is the gift of life in the moment. And therefore, as a human being, the freedom to choose how you use this moment. What do we do because of our mind? Our mind prevents us from living in this moment 100%. Now, one of the things we always need to remind ourselves, can we do an open eye meditation? Can you feel the chair you're seated on? Can you feel the ground where your foot is resting on? Can you feel the air around you? Any background sounds? Can you feel the sensation on your tongue? The taste or the smell in your nostril. Now, the more we come into the senses for a moment at least, or when we practice, am I aware of my breathing in this moment? Temporarily, my mind is taken away. And when my mind is not there, I am able to live this moment. What does the mind do? The mind brings in the past or brings in the future. And I'm not able to live in real time. And when I'm not able to live in real time, and if I live in psychological time, that is how our life gets messed up. And therefore, what is the sadhana for this? The sadhana for this is all the sadhanas of meditation. All our techniques of upasana, which Sri Krishna emphasized in this chapter, are primarily to help us. Remember, at the end of the 7th of the 6th chapter, Arjuna asked, my mind is chanchala. It is, it cannot be still even for a moment. So Krishna reminds you, kama esha krodha esha. Kama means, I'm not able to accept this moment fully. There is a desire which says, I wish it could be something else. And the moment I'm not able to accept this moment fully, then I fight with this moment. I'm not able to live the greatest gift that I have, the gift of this moment. And therefore, I have to do various forms of sadhanas to feel the gift of this moment. The topic for today, which I will, I have already used about 4 minutes of my 5 minutes time, which I will speak at the conclusion, is this mind, which I have so far told is a problem mind, can also be a useful mind. There is a second mantra in the Upanishad called Amrita Vidhi Upanishad, which says, Mana eva manushyanam karana bandha mokshaye. The mind is the cause of bondage. Swami Param says the untrained mind is the cause of bondage. The same mind, if it is properly programmed, if it can be properly used, it can be like a very useful asset that we have, like the mobile telephone. Today, suddenly, if you have to leave the home, the first thing you will grab and go, you may not worry about your wallet, you may not worry about anything, because your mobile telephone carries your money, it has your ID, it has got your, you know, emergency contacts. It is everything in one. So too, even more useful is your mind. Now, right now, when you're listening, your mobile is in a silent mode so that it does not disturb you, so that you can live this mind, this moment fully. So too, I would like you to see what are the advantages of the mind and what are the disadvantages of the mind. Before I conclude, I would like to say one more disadvantage of the mind. Even in a spiritual path, we are always comparing, you know, he is so much better off. Where will I ever come to his level? Where is Swami Param? Where is Swami Chinmayananda? So when you begin to compare, then you always feel in relation to others, I have not accomplished anything. And that is where, again, we don't feel that sense of Purnatvam. And therefore, the highest role model in the spiritual path is Gautama Buddha. And Gautama Buddha had said, if one person can attain, it is everybody's potential to attain. Now, I will take you to the usefulness of the mind at the conclusion of this talk. We come to the concluding verses of Akshara Brahma Yoga, verse 23. Vibha, it is your time.
Hari Om. Can you hear me properly?
Perfect. Go ahead.
Yes. Okay. Yatra kale tvanavrittam avrittam chaiva yoginah prayata yanti tam kalam vakshyami varatar shabha. Arjuna, the foremost clan of Bharata, I will tell you what are the rules the departed yogis take. In this verse, Krishna talks about two kinds of path which leads to two destinations. And every destination does have a path. So the paths are anavritam, which is the infinite goal, that is a path with no return. And anavriti means non-returnable goal, which indicates nitya moksha praptihi or krama mukti. And the other destination is avriti. Avriti means returnable goal, where they go with a return ticket. They cannot permanently stay there. Loka praptihi. Excluding a tiny section of people who take to the study of Advaita Vedanta, the majority of Hinduism very deeply believe in the travel of Sukshma Sharira in a particular way to reach the heavenly destinations. That's why at the time of death, many people perform the rituals believing that, you know, the Sukshma Sharira will travel easily. And some people, even when they're alive, they perform these rituals thinking they want to go to these higher lokas. The two paths here are the bright path and the dark path. In the bright path is for upasakas who has done a lot of upasanas as per the scriptures, and with the power of this accumulated punya, he travels on the bright path, goes to Brahmaloka, receives self-knowledge from Brahmaji and gets liberated. And in the second path, the person who travels here does not have enough punya to go to the Brahmaloka. He travels to other lokas, spends his punya. As a result of his stay in these lokas, have exhausted all the punya, and the Sukshma Sharira takes up a new body and is born. This is the idea as presented. Even though in Advaita Vedanta, our entire focus is on Jivan Mukti, to be liberated here and now, scriptures do talk about the travel of Sukshma Sharira. Gita, being a universal scripture, gives a place for the aspirations of upasakas who have a desire to go to these higher lokas. But as Vedantins, we know that Jivan Mukti is the most practical thing to aspire for. Who knows whether one is going to Brahmaloka or not? Who knows one is going to get liberated in Brahmaloka? So I firmly decided to no more traveling. I will stay here, get liberated here and now in this very life. And in Ashtavakra Gita, it says the seeker is the sort, one who aspires for liberation is already liberated. All that is required in Vedanta is to develop a firm conviction that is, I am already liberated. Chidananda Rupa Shivoham Shivoham.
Thank you. Thanks, Vibha, for a very clear and very strong message that all of us, this is it. We are here for Adyo Mukti. We are not here for any travel. Indu, your time.
Audible, sir?
Clear, very clear. Go ahead.
Sri Guru Bhyo Namaha. In verse 23, we have known about the two paths. If there are two goals to be gained, there must necessarily be two different paths guiding the two types of seekers to their respective destinations. The Lord promises that He will explain both the path of return and the path of no return. The path pursued by those who have no return is as follows. Agnir Jyotiraha Shuklaha Shanmasa Uttarayanam Tatra Prayata Gachanti Brahma Brahmavido Janaha. Prayata departing, Tatra by that bright path, Agnihi, which is presided over by the deities of fire, Jyotihi, flame, Ahaha, day, Shuklaha, the bright fortnight, Shanmasa Uttarayanam, and the 6 months of the sun's northern course, Janaha Brahmavidaha. Those people who meditate on Saguna Brahman Gachanti, Brahma, attain Brahman. Departing by the bright path, which is presided over by the deities of fire, flame, day, the bright fortnight, and the 6 months of sun's northern course, those people who meditate on Saguna Brahman attain Brahman. So in this verse, Krishna defines the brighter path called Shukla Marga or Shukla Gati or Devayana. Tatra means Devayanaha Shukla Margena Prayataha. Those who go via Shukla Marga, through Shukla Marga, Brahma Gachanti, they will attain Brahman, Ishvara or Krama Mukti, that is gradual liberation. Here the word Brahma refers to Krama Mukti Praptihi, gradually going to Ishvara. They go to Brahmaloka, and in Brahmaloka, they will get Aham Brahmasmi Jnanam. Then having obtained the knowledge of Aham Brahmasmi, they will get liberation. Therefore, Shukla Margena Prayataha Brahma Gachyati. Now, what is the nature of the Shukla Marga? While talking about these two paths, the scriptures tells us that there are guides, devatas, to help these seekers or travelers to reach Brahmaloka. Who are these devatas who are guiding? Krishna is giving the names of these devatas as Agni, Jyotihi, Ahaha, Shukla, Uttarayanam, and these five devatas are the guides for these seekers. Agni Devata, Jyoti Devata, Ahar Devata. Ahaha means daytime literally, but here it is the name of the Devata, Ahar Devata. Similarly, Shukla refers to Shukla Paksha Devata, deity of Shukla Paksha, and Uttarayana means Uttarayana Devata. Uttarayana Devata consists of 6 months. When the sun is going towards north and the Lord is governing the law of this sun's movement, it is called a Devata. Devata refers to intelligent principle governing the law of nature. All the devatas put together is called Hiranya Garbha Tattvam. These five devatas preside over or guide the seeker who travels through Shukla Marga, and by this marga, the seeker travels. Next question is, who is the traveler? Upanishad says that they are special people entitled to travel in this route. They are Brahmavido Janaha, means Saguna Brahma Upasakaha. Next question is, what about jnanis? They will also not get shukla gati because they need not get krama mukti. They have attained liberation here and now. Ritualists will not get krama mukti or jivan mukti also. They will have to go through the other routes. This route is only for the upasakas to go to Brahmaloka, gain jnanam and liberation. Therefore, Brahma vidaha saguna ishvara upasakaha. Thus, we have got the root and also the seeker. To sum up, the gist of this verse is Shuklagati is the root and Saguna Ishvara Upasaka is the seeker. Thank you.
Thanks, Sindhu. Very nice. Very nice and a clear interpretation, presentation of this verse. Diksha Vindhya. Go ahead.
Yes, Doctor. Yes, Doctor, am I audible?
Very clear.
ओमो रात्रिस्थत कृष्णः षण्मासा दक्षिणायनम् तत्र चांद्रमसं ज्योतिर् योगी प्राप्य निवर्तते. So here Shri Krishna speaks about one of the two paths taken by a jiva after his death based on his actions on earth. We saw earlier that jivas who have practiced single-pointed devotion, travel on the path of light, attain the abode of Lord Brahma, and eventually achieve liberation. Now Shri Krishna describes the path of the jiva who has performed good deeds in his lifetime but has not practiced devotion. This path is called the path of the moon or the lunar path. Here Tatra refers to that alternate path. Swami Param compares Krishna Marga to the roadside streets which are not well lit, and even if there are lights, they won't be burning bright. Therefore, you can decide whether you want to travel by Shukla or Krishna Gati. Yogi here refers to the Karmi, the ritualistic people who do not practice Upasana, but they do all their duties very well. They also do a lot of service, rituals, pujas, etc. So naturally, they will get punyam. But the punyam that they obtain is of a lower quality because they would not have done upasana, which is considered a higher sadhana. Any mental sadhana is supposed to be of a higher quality than any physical sadhana. This is because mental sadhana is more difficult as the mind runs all over from one thought to another thought. So therefore, mere ritualists would get punyam, but of a lower order. And therefore, he goes through Tatra, which refers to the Krishna Marga, and reaches Chandra Masam Jyotihi, which means he reaches only Swarga Loka or heaven, otherwise known as Chandra Loka, which is lower than the Brahmaloka. Basically they will go to the lower lokas. The lower loka means between the Bhuloka as well as the Brahmaloka. All those intermediary lokas are called Swarga Lokas, and only that Swarga Loka he attains. And now Krishna says, the person will be guided by the devatas along this path. Those devatas are Dhuma Devata. Literally, Dhuma meaning here is smoke. Here, it is the name of the devata. The next is Ratrihi, literally means night. But here it refers to Ratrihi Devata. Similarly, Krishnaha. Krishna in this context means Krishnaha Pasaka Devata, not Vasudeva Krishna. Krishnaha Pasaka means the dark fortnight, and then Sanmasah Dakshinayanam, also known as Dakshinayana Devata. So these four devatas are known to be the guides of the person going through Krishna Marga to attain Swargaloka. In the Upanishads, especially Chandogya and Brihadaranya, the list is more extensive and it is more in detail. Now, if he is going through Swargaloka, why do you call it to be a gloomy path? Should it not be a brighter path? Because Svarga means people should also be happy. Then why does Krishna describe the path to heaven as a dark path? Krishna says the reason is Prapya Nivartate. The bad news is that he will go to Svargaloka and enjoy, yes. But once the Punya gets exhausted, he will undergo rebirth and come down to earth. Punarapi Jananam, Punarapi Maranam. So therefore, compared to Shukla Marga, Krishna Marga certainly is inferior. And therefore, it is dark like the black spot in the sun. But this black spot is not literally a black spot in the sun. It is really bright, but it is considered a black spot because compared to other parts of the sun, it is less bright. And hence, it appears black. Similarly, Krishna Marga is blacker or darker compared to Shukla Gati. Therefore, to conclude, smoke, night, darkness, and the southern movement comprising 6 months, the yogi travels through that path, attains the light of the moon, only to be reborn on earth. Thank you.
Thank you. Another excellent presentation. Very, very clear. You've done full justice to the verse. Good. Proceed to Colonel Vijay. Colonel, your time, sir. Please go ahead.
Vijayan sir, you are muted. Just unmute yourself.
Sir, can you hear me now, sir?
Very clear. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Shukla Krishne Gati Hete Jagat Saswate Mate Ekaha Yataya Anavrati Anyaya Avartate Punaha. These two parts of the world, known as the bright path and the dark path, are indeed considered to be eternal. By the former, one attains the world of non-return. By the latter, one comes back again. We have seen in the previous verses, talking about the Uttarayana and the various deities of the Uttarayana and the Dakshinayana and the various deities presiding over it. In this sloka, Krishna gives the name of the two paths defined in the preceding verses. He says, Hete Gati Shukla Krishna. These two paths are named as Shukla Gati and Krishna Gati, or Shukla Marga and Krishna Marga. It may also be called Devyanam and Prityanam, respectively. These two paths were created along with the creation of the universe. Hence, Jagat Saswate Mate. As we know, the Vedas came into existence along with the creation, followed by human being and the various sadhakas. Therefore, the paths came into existence along with the Srishti and would resolve in Pralayam. Hence, these are eternal as the universe. Following the Shukla Gati, the Shukla Marga, a person will get taken mukti by going to the Brahma Loka, Anavrutam Yati. The route is like a hopper flight with a stopover at the Brahma Loka, where one gains the Brahma Gyanam and Kramamukti. Following the other path of Krishna Gati or Krishna Marga, a person will obtain Svarga Loka as he has done various noble karmas. And once these punyas are exhausted in the Svarga Loka, he comes back. Avartate Punaha. The previous two shlokas project a degree of confusion which can be resolved through the Brahma Sutras. Krishna says, whoever dies during the Shukla Paksha or Uttarayana Kale or Aha, daytime, will go to Krama Mukti. Similarly, when a person dies during the Krishna Paksha or the night, will get into Krishna Gati. This prompts one to understand that time of death is a factor deciding the path of mukti or direction of journey. However, after elaborate analysis in the Brahma Sutras, it has been established that the time of death does not determine the direction of journey, but it is the quality of life that determines the direction of journey. Thank you, sir. Hari Om.
Thank you, Colonel Vijayan, for giving us a nice idea. Otherwise, this Uttarayana and Dakshinayana gives a wrong idea that if your timing of your death determines everything. So, thank you. Proceed. Dr. Sheila, it's your time.
Yes. Namaste. Gurubhyo Namaha.
Continue.
Sir, I'm heard?
Clear.
Yeah. I'll chant the verse. Naite Shriti Partha Janan Yogi Muhyate Kaschana Tasmat Sarveshu Kaleshu Yoga Yukto Bhavarjuna. This one here, I'll explain this. Ete Shriti, these two paths, Janan, by knowing these two paths, Partha, Kaschana, any. No dhyana nishtha will get deluded ever. Tasmat, that is therefore, sarveshu kaleshu, any time, all times, yoga yukta bhavarjuna, hey Arjuna, you be fixed in that dhyana yoga only. Here, this is a very simple shloka, and last but one verse of this chapter. Already, all our friends and sir have spoken in detail about all the verses. So, let me just reinforce some of the points which are already been spoken. Here in this chapter, we are talking about Saupadika Brahman, that is not Nirupadika Brahmana, that is Saguna Brahmana, Brahman, which is associated with certain attributes or delimiting factors. In the beginning of the chapter, Krishna explains some manifestations of Brahman, like Adi Bhautika, Adi Daivam, Adi Yajna, etc. These can be used as alambana, as support for upasana. So what is upasana? Shankaracharya explains, defines it as continuous stream of similar thoughts, unaffected by or undisturbed by dissimilar thoughts. It is a sadhana which is done by the mind as an instrument. Here we are talking about saguna brahma vishaya manasa vyaparaha. This upasana can be sakama or nishkama. One is for material benefits, that is remembering the higher lokas for superior material pleasures. The other one is nishkama upasana, which is meant for inner growth of a person. He values spiritual growth more than material accomplishment. This gives qualification to jnana yoga abhyasaha. So let us talk now about prayana kale smaranam. At the time of death, last thought, that is antya bhavana, is an indicator of the lifestyle of a person, that is samskara, and that should be built up over a period of time, and this determines the next janma. So after the fall of body, linga sharira or sukshma sharira remains. The important component of this is antakarana, which is nothing but a baggage of samskara, good, bad and ugly things which a person has done. So this person has not transcended his identification with the body mind intellect complex, that is parichinnatva buddhi or delimited buddhi. So long as person has parichinna buddhi, he cannot escape from the body, so it has to travel to other lokas. Here Swamiji says that loka is not a physical entity somewhere, it is experiential state of mind. So remember one thing, it is the movement of only the insentient, that is a sukshma sharira or linga sharira, not for chetana, atma or consciousness. So there are two paths. This goes with the two paths. One is devayana, divine path, or for the better future, that is sukla gati. And the second one is Krishna path or pitruyana, Dhuma Marga, Dhar Path for Punarjanma. One thing here, this Gati or Margas are not for everyone in the world. It is only for eligible people. Those who are in this Dhyana Yoga or Upasana Yoga or Karma Path. Karma Path is those who follow karma as per the scriptures and Karma Yogis. This does not include Jnani. He has no Gati, no Marga. He himself is of nature of Brahman. He has expanded himself. His ego has been annihilated and merged in the Supreme Brahman. This is Sadhyo Mukti or Jivan Mukti. So now, Saguna Brahma Upasaka, through his divine grace, a Linga Shariram is taken to Brahma Loka, where he gets Brahma as a guru and he gets liberation. This is Krama Mukti or the phased liberation. I think Divya said that Nitya Moksha Marga also, that is what it is. When you go there, definitely you are going to get Moksha. So that is also called as a Nitya Marga, that is Moksha Marga. So there is no return to this play, to this world, that is also called as Anavritti. So Krishna Gati is for Karmis, that is Avritti Marga, where they have come back and there is a Punar Janma. To conclude, Shubhyam Margabhyam Vahanti Vasana Sarat Paurushesena Prayatnena Yojanya Shubhamati. What he says is develop good vasanas so that subconscious mind is saturated with Mangala Samskara. So Krishna says, elevate yourself from Karma Yogi to Dhyana Nishta, that is Nishkama Upasaka, so that you can attain God in Brahma Loka through Krama Mukti. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Shiva, for giving us a nice summary of the 8th chapter and giving us a message to acquire good vasanas. We come to the last verse of this chapter. Panaga, your time.
हरि ओम श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः वेदेषु यज्ञेषु तपस्सु चैव दानेषु यत् पुण्यफलं प्रदिष्टम् अत्येति तत्सर्वमिदं विदित्वा योगी परं स्थानमुपैति चाद्यम् कमिंग टू द शब्दार्थ वी स्टार्ट फ्रॉम द सेकंड लाइन योगी योगी हियर रेफर्स टू द निष्काम उपासक Idam sarvam viditva, who has understood all that I have taught so far, param adhyam sthanam upaiti, attains the supreme and beginningless destination of Nitya Ishvara. Yat punyafalam pradishtam, that punyafalam that one begets through Vedeshu, parayana of the Vedas, Yagneshu, performance of rituals, tapasu, practice of vows or vratas, and daneshu, charity, tat atyeti. The Upasana Phalam transcends all of these Karma Phalam. In this concluding verse of the 8th chapter, Krishna glorifies the Nishkama Upasaka. This Upasaka is compared against a Karmi who performs noble actions and rituals but always craves for material benefits. The Karmi can never attain Jivan Mukti or Krama Mukti because his goal is only Dharma, Artha or Kama. Whereas a Nishkama Upasaka, while performing noble duties, seeks the Lord without excessively yearning for worldly pleasures. Due to this detachment and singular focus on the Lord throughout his life, he has saturated his conscious and subconscious mind with good thoughts. So even at the critical time of death, he is able to think of the Lord and attains moksha through Krama Mukti. Hence, Krishna ends the 8th chapter by telling Arjuna to choose Upasana over Karma, because Karma Phalam can only give finite Swarga, while Upasana Phalam gives Nitya Ishvara. An important aspect to note is that Krishna excludes Jnana from this discussion and instead focuses on what happens to the Ajnani devotee meditating on Saguna Ishvara. This distinguishes the 8th chapter from all the other chapters in the Madhyama Shatkam, because here Krishna tells us to become Nishkama Upasakas and attain Krama Mukti. But in all the other chapters, Krishna extols us to become Jnanis and attain Jivan Mukti here and now. This chapter is titled Akshara Brahma Yoga because Krishna begins his teaching with the words Akshara Brahma Paramam in verse 3. This chapter can also be called Pranakale Smaranam chapter. Thus, I chant the chapter conclusion. ओम तत्सत इति श्रीमद् भगवत गीतासु उपनिषत्सु ब्रह्म विद्यायां योग शास्त्रे श्री कृष्णार्जुन संवादे अक्षर ब्रह्म योगो नाम अष्टमोध्यायः. Before I close, I'd like to share a beautiful story about the certainty of death. Once there was a conference of the gods at Mount Kailash. Vishnu came on his Garuda, Ganesha on his Moshika, Indra riding the Airavata, Brahma on the Hamsa, Shani on his crow, and so on. They were all greeted by Shiva and went inside a cave. Garuda found himself a nice spot on the mountain top and settled down. A sweet song came to his ears and he looked around and saw that it was coming from a beautiful blue bird perched on a tree. Garuda was lost in the song. Suddenly he was awakened by the sound of thundering footsteps like that of a raging bull. He looked down and there was Yama. Yama dismounted from his bull and started racing up the mountain because he was late. But suddenly he stopped, turned around and fixed his gaze on the tiny blue bird. He had a quizzical look on his face, but since he was already late, he continued up the mountain and went inside. Garuda, who was watching, knew that Yama's look meant sure death for the bird. He was engulfed by pity. He decided to rescue the bird before Yama could come out and carry the bird away with him. So he flew out and told the bird what was about to happen. The bird became frightened and asked Garuda for help. Garuda then lifted the bird onto his large back and reached for the skies. With his massive wingspan, he flew thousands of miles south and reached a dense forest. There, he settled the bird in the hollow of an old tree by the side of a river. Confident that Yama couldn't find the bird here, Garuda flew back to Mount Kailash. The conference had just concluded and the gods were starting to come out of the cave. Yama emerged with Vishnu by his side. Garuda, who was still concerned about the bird, went up to them and asked, "O Lord Yama, when you arrived for the conference, you fixed your gaze at a beautiful blue bird. Pray, tell me why you had that quizzical look on your face?" Lord Yama said, "O Garuda, that bird had reached the end of its time. It was supposed to be swallowed by a serpent in the hollow of an old tree by the side of a river in a dense forest thousands of miles south from here. I was wondering how the small bird with its tiny wings could cover such a large distance in such a short period. But now I gather that it has happened." Garuda was struck with grief and guilt that he had caused the bird's death. Then Lord Vishnu explains, "O Garuda, every living being's death is certain. You were just an instrument. Be rest assured, the bird has met its destiny." So friends, neither can we predict the results of our actions, nor the when, where, and how of our death. We can only choose to live each moment now mindfully, thanking the Lord. Thank you.
Thanks, Panaga. Very nice conclusion of the 8th chapter with a very, very powerful story and very picturesquely done. We had visions of Mount Kailash also as you were speaking. We come to the next chapter, which is Raja Yoga, Raja Guhya Yoga. And to Dr. Prasanna, it is your verse. Are you ready?
Prasanna, I think you have to unmute yourself.
Yeah, I have done. Can you hear me now?
Clear.
Oh, yes, yes, sure, clear.
हरि ओम नवमोध्याय राजविद्या राजभुजयोग नाइन्थ द योग ऑफ सॉवरिंग साइंस एंड सॉवरिंग सीक्रेट श्री कृष्ण यूजेस दिस चैप्टर टू प्रोग्रेस द थीम ऑफ द सेवेंथ चैप्टर विच वाज द इनफिनिट नेचर ऑफ ईश्वर एंड फाइनाइट नेचर ऑफ माया द नाइन्थ चैप्टर ऑफ भगवद्गीता इज ऑफ पैरामाउंट इंपॉर्टेंस इट डील्स विद Raja Vidya, sovereign knowledge, and Raja Guhya, sovereign secret. For the first time, we know that the initiative passes from the questioner to the answerer in the presence of Krishna, who himself represents the absolute, and Lord begins the chapter asserting that the knowledge of Ishwara's infinite nature will result in liberation. And the verse goes as follows. श्री भगवान उवाच इदं तु ते गृहत्मं गृह हलो श्री भगवान उवाच इदं तु ते गृहत्वं
इदं तु ते गुह्यतमं प्रवक्ष्याम्यानसूयवे ज्ञानं विज्ञानसहितं यज्ञात्वा मोक्षसेशुभात।
The translation, the Lord said, however to you who are non-critical, I shall impart this jnana along with vijnana, which is the greatest secret, and going which jnana you'll be free from samsara. Krishna introduces the subject matter in the first three verses, and the subject matter of the ninth chapter is going to be Ishvara Jnanam. Bhagavan Krishna is not interested in Krama Mukti. He wants to introduce Krama Mukti only as a topic of academic interest, because Krama Mukti is meant for inferior seekers, and Krishna feels Arjuna does not come under this category. Krishna says, hey Arjuna, in this chapter I am going to give the knowledge of both Apara and Paraprakriti. The knowledge of the higher nature of God is Vijnanam, and lower nature of nature is called Jnanam. Therefore, I am going to give both Jnanam and Vijnanam. He says, Idam Vijnana Sahitam Jnanam Aham Pravakshyami. Lord says, very rarely people are interested in talking Ishvara Swarupam, and even if there are people interested, they love only talking about Saguna Ishvara Swarupam. And very rarely are people interested in the higher Nirguna Swarupam. And therefore Krishna says, this is the topmost secret, Guhyatmam, the greatest secret. And Krishna uses the word secret. Not only it is the topmost secret, a rarest and greatest knowledge. Yat Jnatva Esubhot Mukshyase. Therefore Krishna gives a promise, Yat Jnatva, gaining this knowledge, you will be released from Ashubha, you will be released from samsara. So all kind of agony, pain that you will have will go away. You will have a free life, which is called Jivan Mukti. And this is the benefit of this knowledge. Lord himself has chosen to part this knowledge with Arjuna. There is no Arjuna Uvacha in this chapter. Arjuna has not even asked. Krishna voluntarily teaches Arjuna, and Lord gives the reason, Anasuye te aham vakshyami. O Arjuna, you have got the rarest of quality, which is required for a student, a non-critical approach. It is very important attitude called Shraddha, open-mindedness. Shraddha van labate jnanam. And O Arjuna, you have got that attitude. Therefore, you are called Anasuye. So because of this unique qualification, I have chosen to teach you. Shri Krishna further glorifies this special knowledge in the coming shlokas. Hari Om.
Thank you, Prasanna. Very nice and a complete explanation of this verse. We come to the last verse for today on Raja Vidya Raja Guhya Nilima.
Yes, in Gita 8th chapter, elaborate Saguna Ishvara Upasana about Apara Prakriti, that is meditation on Lord with attributes, which is leading to Krama Mukti, as one does not possess the knowledge of Lord's higher nature. In 9th chapter, we see emphasis is more on Nirguna Ishvara Upasana or Lord's essential nature, Para Prakriti, Jnana Yoga, leading to Sadhya Mukti or Jivan Mukti. Let us stand the verse. Raja Vidya Raja Guhyam Pavitramidam Uttamam Pratyakshavagam Dharmyam Susukam Kartum Avyayam. Andaya, Idam Raja Vidya. This self-knowledge is king of all sciences. Raja Guhyam, greatest secret. Pavitram Uttamam, the most sacred. Supremely purifying. Pratyakshavagamam, clearly comprehensible by one's own direct experience. Dharmyam, in accordance with Vedic tradition. Kartum susukam, easily practiced.
avyayam, the knowledge of Brahma is eternal. In order to develop enthusiasm in the pursuit of self, for a student, this knowledge of self is praised in this verse. Knowledge of Nirguna Ishvara is considered as a Rajavidya, king of all sciences. Like, however beautiful the dream might be, but the waking state experience is greatest when compared to all the joys of dream. To wake up and know who we are, our higher reality, is the highest knowledge. In Yoga Vasishta, we get to see Vasishta giving, teaching this knowledge to Rama. Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, Janaka having this knowledge. Ashwapati, Manu, such great kings of yore had possessed this knowledge. To accomplish great things, one needs great knowledge. Knowing Lord is at once both immanent and transcendent, and realizing oneness with the God, Jnana Yogi knows himself as a microcosm of immanence and transcendence. Such wise people remain working in the world without losing awareness of their sublime soul nature, and thus escapes entanglements and attains fulfillment and liberation here and now. Knowing all the sciences as transactional reality, Vyavaharika Satta, Lord is Paramarthika Satta, is the highest knowledge. This knowledge is considered as Rajagukhyam, since it is not accessible to unprepared mind who have not practiced Saguna Ishvara Dhyana before. For such ignorant, this knowledge is too profound for his lay understanding. This knowledge is Pavitram Uttamam. Of all the purifier, Brahma Jnana is the best purifier. In fourth chapter,
the audio is gone.
Hello, Nilima. See if you can unmute. Audio is gone, sir.
Audio is gone. All right. We will, shall I continue?
So she's there. She is not able to unmute, I think. Hello, Nilima? No, sir. Yes, sir. You can conclude, I think.
So, we have come to the end of the 8th chapter, and now we are looking into the 9th chapter. And the 9th chapter is a promise. Krishna is going to give us a large secret. I had mentioned about the lot of disadvantages of the mind, and now I said, let us see what is the usefulness of the mind. Now we have to come to terms that the greatest gift that we have, or the greatest tool that we have to accomplish anything in this world, is this mind. Mana eva manushyanam karana bandha moksha. We saw all the disadvantages. Another disadvantage we found, that the mind is always tends to compare with other people and say, you are not good enough. Somebody has very nicely said, no one is superior to me. No one is inferior to me. I am what I am. Each one of us is unique, and therefore there is no comparison. So we essentially need to flower to be ourselves. To make the most of our mind, we need to wake up with a feeling of how blessed we are, that we have all our faculties intact, and to be able to make the most of our life. To make the most of our life, we need to see that we have our dreams and our aspirations. And it is, you know, always we need to transcend ourselves. So this is the, although normally we say dreams or aspirations are desire, our life is because of desire. Unless there is desire to live, to desire to eat, to desire to enjoy, there is no fullness of life. So let us see desire in a positive angle and see how we can make the most. Every creation happens twice, first in the human mind and then in reality. What is that which we need to be able to create? To be able to create anything, we need a positive state of mind, and that positive state of mind comes from a state of, so I'm so blessed, and this is the attitude of gratitude. We have heard it in the Kathopanishad, and every day we also hear it in the Gita Dhyana Shlokas about Vasudevasutam Devam Kamsachanura Mardanam Devaki Paramanandam Krishnam Vande Jagatguru. From the Kathopanishad with the Nachiketa's discussion, and this Dhyana Shloka of Vasudevasutam Devam, it has been deduced that we have three Ranas. These three Ranas are called Pitrarina, Lokarina, and Acharirina. The first boon, Nachiketa said, let my father be happy. Vasudevasutam Devam, Devaki Paramananda. Can we bring joy to our parents? What is the greatest joy we can give to our parents? Is that if you live in such a way that others can able to say how blessed your parents are, if they have a son or a daughter like you. The second Rina is Lokarina. All of us have got certain talents which perhaps nobody else has. If we are able to bring those talents into the forefront and therefore fully exploit these talents, in what way we can serve community? Through Karma Yoga. And finally, the most difficult one is our Parama Purusharta. We are here for Parama Purusharta. Now, can we program our right brain? Can we use proper vasanas, bring in Shubha vasanas, work out on the other vasanas so that we will be able to work on that V, which Swami Chinmayananda shows on his BMI chart, to reach to Parama Purusharta. What do we really want? We want to become Purnatvam. We want to go beyond any form of limitations. Now, there is a nice forms of meditations way, which we said, if you want anything in your life, the left brain has to tell you.
It got connected. It's about mind is useful, is that?
Yes. Only yours could not be unmuted actually. Suddenly,
it just went off. Is it now?
We'll do a little later. I will just continue. We have the two kinds of the brain, the left brain and the right brain. Now, the left brain tells me what I want in life, that I need to attain to Parama Purusharta. And the right brain gives a certain picture, right? Like, you know, when you say a child in school, you have A for apple. There is a symbol which activates the left brain. There is a picture that activates the right brain. So there are various forms of meditation which activate on the Agnya Chakra. And once the Agnya Chakra is activated, through certain affirmations, we can program our mind through various, this is what is called various upasana that we can do to tell yourself that this is what I'm here for. I'm here to be able to attain to Purnatvam, and that there will be no stops, that I'm going to work for Purnatva. Let me conclude by telling you a nice story from Vidyaranya Swami. Vidyaranya Swami was a great upasaka of Devi, particularly Lakshmi. And because he had so much of financial limitations, he did every form of upasana to invoke Goddess Lakshmi. And Goddess Lakshmi never appeared to him. And it so happened that he took sannyas. On the day he took sannyas, Goddess Lakshmi appears to him and says, what can I give you? And he says, see, now I have taken sannyas, I don't need anything. She said, see, I have manifested in front of you personally. You must ask for something. He said, right now, I don't need anything. And he says, you know, he was in such a dilemma. My question for you, Vidyaranya's story was very beautiful. He does not ask her for anything. And you know what Devi finally says? If you don't ask for anything, I will give you everything. She showers him with everything. That is Vidyaranya's story. My question for you is, we are all sadhakas. We are working for Purnatvam. And I want you to imagine that day when you have attained Purnatvam. And Goddess Lakshmi appears to you and says, what is that I can give you? What will you ask? Let me share one story which I like particularly. The story looks a little odd. This is a story of a man who constantly prayed to God for wealth. And then once God manifests to him and says, I'm tired of your prayers. You are always bugging me with your prayers. I will give you three boons. You can ask me whatever you want. The man suddenly looked at God and said, see, all my misfortune is because of my wife. If she dies, I will have some peace. His wife died at a funeral. So many people came and said, what a wonderful lady she was. Each person after person came and praised the wife. he went to God and said, I want her back. And finally, two wishes over, he had only one wish left. Now he was wondering what to ask. He had made a mistake. Now he did not want to make a mistake. He wanted to ask for the best in the world, and he consulted so many people. He was thoroughly confused. And in his confusion, he decided not to make a decision. He was getting old. God manifests to him and says, I've given you a boon. Why don't you ask? And the man tells God, Bhagwan, so I'm so glad that you have come. Can I have an extra boon? And God says, what is that? He says, can you in your intelligence tell me what to ask? Friends, God gives him the answer. And this is what I think is the greatest thing that we can ask. What we can ask for is, and this is what God says, ask to be content no matter what you receive. Can you make this moment a moment of Purnatvam, irrespective of limitations in your body, mind, finances, or whatever? If I can have the grace to be able to accept this moment fully, then there is nothing else that you can require. And therefore, if our will would be to work for Purnatvam, or let us give it either Purnatvam or the ability to accept God's will cheerfully, so that we will be able to live our lives fully. I was to conclude with Purnamada, but I will give Nilima her chance to complete a verse. Nilima.
Thank you, sir. So, do I need to start? Yes, sir. Shall I start the verse from the beginning, sir?
Continue. Please continue.
In Gita, 8th chapter, it elaborates Saguna Ishvara Upasana about Apara Prakriti, which was mentioned in 7th chapter, that is meditation on lords with attributes leading to krama mukti, as one does not possess knowledge of lord's higher nature. In 9th chapter, more emphasis is on nirguna ishvara upasana, lord's essential nature para prakriti, or jnana yoga leading to sadhya mukti or jivan mukti. Let us chant the verse. राजविद्या राजगुह्यं पवित्रमिदमुत्तमं प्रत्यक्षावगम धर्म्यं सुसुकं कर्तुमव्ययम्. अन्वय इदं राजविद्या, दिस सेल्फ नॉलेज इज अ किंग ऑफ ऑल साइंसेस. राजगुह्यं, ग्रेटेस्ट सीक्रेट. पवित्रम, उत्तमम, मोस्ट सीक्रेट, सुप्रीमली प्यूरिफाइंग. प्रत्यक्षावगमम, क्लियरली कॉम्प्रिहेंसिबल बाय वन्स ओन डायरेक्ट एक्सपीरियंस. Dharmyam, in accordance with Vedic tradition. Kartum susukum, easily practiced. Avyayam, the knowledge of Brahma is eternal. Knowledge of Nirguna Ishvara is considered as Rajavidya, king of all sciences. It's like, however beautiful the dream might be, but the waking state experience is greatest when compared to the joys of dreams. To wake up and know who we are, our higher reality is the highest knowledge. In Yoga Vasishta, we get to see Vasishta's teaching this knowledge to Rama. In Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, Janaka having this knowledge, Ashwapati, Manu, and such a great sings of yore had possessed this knowledge. To accomplish great things, we need to have a greater knowledge. In order to develop enthusiasm in the pursuit of the self, for the student, this knowledge of the self is praised in this verse. This knowledge is considered as a Rajaguhyam, since it is not accessible to unprepared mind who have not practiced Saguna Ishvara Dhyana before. For such ignorant, this knowledge is too profound for his lay understanding. This knowledge is Pavitram Uttamam. Of all the purifier, Brahma Dhyana is the best purifier. In 4th chapter, 38th verse, also indicating the same meaning, Nahi jnanena sadrusham pavitra miha vidyate, as it instantly reduces to ashes the entire past karmas of all the ages with the roots which are in the form of dharma and adharma. Just as a lamp, when lighted, instantly destroys the darkness of ages. So it is the greatest purifier. This knowledge is Pratyakshavagamam, because the supreme to be seen by one as one's own self through one's developed and purified intuition. This knowledge is dharmyam, because it is accordance with a Vedic tradition spiritual science called dharma. The term dharma is explained as law of being. A conscious principle blessing both gross and subtle bodies with awareness. Dharma is the deepest essence in each individual. Susukam kartum. This knowledge has been fully confirmed that the technique of self-integration and complete mastery over oneself. It's an art easy to master for the sincere and diligent when taught by a qualified teacher. This knowledge is avyayam. This liberation arising out of the knowledge of Brahma is eternal. Yajnatva na punar mohamevam yasyasi pandava. So this knowledge of Brahma should be pursued by all who desire peace and happiness. Thank you.
Thank you, Nilima. So there is a lot of interest now in the ninth chapter, which is an elaboration of the seventh chapter, where you will understand the nature of God very clearly. And some of the best verses of bhakti is there in this chapter. So we will learn what is the secret that Krishna wants to give. And in the 15th chapter, the last word is iti guhyatamam shastram, that he delivers to Anaga Parta. With that, we will conclude today's class. Thanks for all the speakers for a wonderful presentation. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti 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 Om Sarve Bhavantu Sukhinaha Sarve Santu Niramayaha Sarve Bhadrani Pashyantu Ma Kaschid Dukkha Bhak Bhavet Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.